So today we're going to talk about how to extract a secure key from the data that Alice and Bob get in the first round. We'll use the data we got yesterday to demonstrate this so you can see physically what happens. So we mentioned yesterday, you know, in the real world, in any real experimental implementation of these ideas, there will be errors. There's going to be errors, you know, losses in the channel maybe, or errors introduced in the channel between Alice and Bob, or errors in Alice's preparation, errors in Bob's measurement. And I think you're going to talk about this a little bit more with Evan in the next lectures. But just to note that, you know, this all the theory is all very nice, but there's always actual errors in any string that Alice and Bob produce. So in the sort of main protocol that we talked about yesterday, we said that Alice and Bob can announce some of their bits and they can compare to see if there are any errors. And if there are, then they can conclude that there's an eavesdropper. And then they have to run the protocol again. But of course, that's a bit too simplistic. We can deal with some level of errors. And so there are protocols that Alice and Bob can run to both correct these errors and to make sure that Eve knows very little about the resulting string. Okay? So as we said yesterday, to ensure security, they have to assume that all these errors are due to Eve, because they could be, even though we know that there's really experimental implementations. And when Alice and Bob have performed the protocol, everything they have now is classical, right? They share this classical bit string, which is somewhat correlated, maybe not perfectly correlated. So now we can refer to classical methods, like classical error correction and privacy amplification that we'll talk about in a minute, which are sort of somewhat well understood classically. The quantum part is over. So today we'll talk about how to do these and we'll apply them to the data we got yesterday. So based on the shared bits that they announced, they can estimate the error key. And then they can estimate the error rate in their sifted key. And then Alice and Bob would like to identify and correct errors. So I'm going to go through these protocols as we're going through our data. So we're going to start off by going through yesterday's data. So I have Alice, Bob, and Eve. Okay. So, right. Yesterday we did the quantum part. Before we can go on to the error correction, we have to do the classical part, which is this basis reconciliation part that we talked about yesterday. Are there any questions about what we talked about yesterday? Did everybody understand what you were doing in the game? Is it too early to ask? Okay, good. So for the bits we had yesterday, I just want Alice and Bob to call out their basis and we'll see whether they agree or not, so you can see how this part works. Okay, so this is enough to get an idea of what we're doing. Alice and Bob, the first bit that you transmitted, you chose a different basis. So this one's no good to us because that bit isn't correlated. So does everybody know what I'm doing now? Anytime you didn't choose the right basis, we don't expect your bits to be correlated, so we discard that information. Okay, so do we have any that you actually agreed on? Okay, so this one. Well, this is going to make the processing easy. This one, and we have two that agree. So out of the first 10, we only have three bits that agree. So we expect about half. Did I miss one? Four. Oh, that's not bad. So we expect about half. So four out of 10 is great. Okay, so this time we have to get rid of this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. 1, 2, 3 agree, this one doesn't, and this one doesn't. Okay, so we've got four more bits. Okay, we're doing okay. Okay, so these agree, this doesn't agree. Okay, thank you. Okay, so here we have one that agrees. Okay, thank you. Okay, good. I don't think I'm going to have room on the board for all 100, so maybe we'll have to stop here. There we go. Now, Alice and Bob have gone through the data, and now we know which ones we expect to be perfectly correlated and which ones we just threw away. So we threw a bunch away. And now, anytime Alice and Bob use the same basis, we expect them to be perfectly correlated. So if they're not, then we know there's an error. So we expect there's an eavesdropper. Okay, so at this point, Alice and Bob announce some of their shared bits. So how many have we got? We should announce a few at random, enough to estimate. So let's start with, what have we got? Number 4 is shared, number 6 is shared, number 9 is shared. Alice, what have you got for number 9? Sorry? Tails. And Bob? Okay, good. 2 degrees. This one's the same, this one's the same. Okay, let's start by announcing, let's say, every 4 to try and estimate the error. So, 1, 2, 3, 17. Okay, so Eve, you've already been found out. You've already introduced an error. Okay, good. 26, you both had horizontal bases?
Yeah.
Okay, so you had heads, you both had heads. Okay, good. One here, how about 33? Okay, good. 41, 51, 59, great, 64, 67, 77, tails, heads, okay, okay, great, so just 2 errors then, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, so we compared 10 bits and we found 2 errors. So we estimate an error rate. We estimate an error rate of about 20%. So obviously in a real implementation, we would want to have the block sizes very large. So Alice and Bob are sharing really a lot of bits, much more than 100. So when they compare sum, that's also a lot of bits, so it's a good estimation of the probability. So obviously when we only have a finite number, we've only compared 10 bits, we're getting an estimate of 20%. That might be, you know, plus or minus a little bit because we have a fairly small sample, okay? Okay, so let's take our estimate as error rate as about 20%. I hope this is going to work. So now they have estimated, you guys have estimated your error rate, and you want to identify where the errors might be. So how do we do it? We want to work through the data and try and find out where the errors are without actually having to compare everything. So there are some ways of doing this. What we're going to talk about is a very simple way. There are more sophisticated techniques, but this is sufficient to show what we want to do. So we start by dividing the remaining bits of the key into subsets of a given length. And we choose the length so that the probability that there's more than one error in that subset is very small. So if we think we have an error at roughly 1 in 5, then if we take a subset of size 5, we think there might be one error in it, roughly. But of course, there could be more than one. So we should choose the length so that the probability there's more than one is quite small. So it should be a little bit less than 5. Let's go for, in fact, maybe, no, then we have to compare half of them. So we'll take subsets of size 3 because the chances are there won't be any errors in each subset, and the chances that there's more than one are very small. Okay. So our subsets will be of length 3. Okay, so what do we do now that we've got our subsets? So for example, for, well, 10, 9 we compared, so we can't use 9. But for 10 and 15, Alice and Bob both measured the same basis on. So now we can combine these ones into one subset. So for 10, 10 and 15, sorry. Oh, sorry, great, thank you. 4, 6, and 10, right? 4, 6, and 10. Okay, so now that we've got these subsets, what are we going to do with them? We want to use this to try to detect errors. So one way they can do this is announce the parity of the bits in each subset. So all you have to do is count up the number of ones in the subset. So here our subsets are of size 3. So if there's one or three bits that are one, then it has odd parity. And if there's two bits that are one, it has even parity. Sorry, is that clear? Okay, so we have it in terms of heads and tails. So let's let heads be 0 and tails be 1. Okay. So let's see, for bits 4, 6, and 10, so you have an odd parity for 4, 6, and 10. And Bob, yours is odd as well. You don't have to tell me what they are. As long as you're comfortable figuring out the parity. Okay, so these both have odd parity. The reason we choose the length of the subset so that it's very unlikely to have two errors in it is so that if the parity agrees, we can assume that there's no error in there. So if the size of the subset is such that there could be one or no errors in there. If there could also be two, we could have had two bits flipped, and that would preserve the parity. So the parity, in our case, we're looking at a subset of three bits. So if you have, 001, for example, that has parity 1 because there's only one appears in the subset once. It's literally just whether the number of ones that appears is odd or even. Parity is just whether the string is odd or even. Okay, so what Alice and Bob would like to do is identify where the errors are and correct them without having to announce everything, because they want to end up with a secret key at the end. Yeah. So this is a way of going through their data and finding out where the errors are, but still having some data remaining at the end of that that's unknown to Eve. So now we've announced the parity. 1 minute. We've given Eve one bit of information about that subset that she didn't have before, right? Because now she knows what the parity of that subset is. So we need to discard something to make sure Eve hasn't gained more information about what we keep in the end. So in practice, what we do is throw away the last bit. So the first part is to check where there's an error in this subset, and we found that there isn't. And then the second part is to make sure that Eve doesn't know anything about the bits we're keeping, so we have to throw away one of the bits. So Eve knows the parity of the three bits. She knows that the parity is odd. But now we've thrown away one bit, which is completely random, so she knows nothing about the remaining two bits. That's equivalent to the one bit that she knew. So now, in your data from yesterday, we're going to throw away bit number 10. So now we think that bits 4 and 6 agree. We've done this error correction. So hopefully they do. So let's go through the rest. We don't have too much to do. Let's see, this one we compared already. It was 17 we compared, right? 17. Okay, so can you look at bits 15, 16, and 19 and tell me what your parity is? 15, 16, and 19, odd? Odd? And Bob? Even. Okay, so there's an error. There's an error in this subset. And if the subset was long enough, then we would split it in half and try and find out where the error is. But because our subset is only size 3, we can't do that because we'll have to announce everything. So basically, there's an error in this subset, and we can't correct it. Okay, so the next lot, we should agree on 21, 22, and 27. Odd? Even? Uh-oh. So those ones are no good. Oh, dear. This might not work out. Okay. Where did I go to? 36. Okay, 37, 40, and 42. Okay, good. Okay, so far we've got 4 bits out of 42. Okay, so we have to throw away 42 because we've announced a bit. So I'm just going to try and keep track of the ones that are still good. 36, right? No, what ones did you just compare? 36, 40, and 42, wasn't it? So 36 and 40 should be good. Okay, 43, 44, and 50. And Bob? Okay, good. So now we keep bits 43 and 44, but we have to throw away 50 because we have to throw away one piece of information. And this one we compared 51, 52, and 54. Okay, good. Odd and odd. So we throw away 54 and we keep 51 and 52. And nearly there, 56, 58, and 62. Okay, good. So 58 and 56 are good. Both odd? Okay, good. 64. Did I miss one? 67 we announced. I should have crossed it off. Yeah, we announced it. So we're crossing off 72 because we just announced a bit. Does everybody know what I'm doing? Okay, good. 74, 76, and 78. Okay, so these, none of these are good. And finally, okay, we only have one left, so we can't do anything with the last one. Okay, so we're left with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We've got about 10 bits. No, a little bit more, maybe 12. So that's just to demonstrate sort of how error correction works. And you've seen what we did. Each time Alice and Bob announced a parity, they had to throw one bit away, so that they weren't giving Eve any more information about the key. So in our case, we threw them away because our subsets were too small. In the general case, so if the subset was much longer, we would try to locate where the error is by binary search, which means split the subset in half and do the same thing on each half. So at the end of this procedure, with high probability, Alice and Bob share the same bit string. Okay, great. So hopefully you have the same bit string for those bits that we've decided to keep. And I've mentioned that much more sophisticated techniques exist. This is basically classical error correction. There's a whole field. So there are more sophisticated techniques. This is a simple one that demonstrates what we're trying to do. Okay, so now we move on to privacy amplification. And again, we're going to discuss a simple protocol. We know that there was an eavesdropper, or we suspect there was an eavesdropper, because we found these errors in the string. So as somebody pointed out, there will be times where Eve chose the right basis, so we won't detect her errors. We won't detect that she induced errors because she chose the right basis, so there'll be no errors. So there will be times where Eve knows the bit that Alice and Bob share. So the next step is to try and get rid of those, to make sure that Eve doesn't know anything about the final key that Alice and Bob share. Okay, so now they use privacy amplification, and we'll talk about a simple technique to do this. So now Alice and Bob choose at random n minus k minus s subsets. So here, n is the total number of bits they have left. K is the estimated number of bits known by Eve, and S is just a security parameter. S you can choose to be as large as you want, depending on how small you want Eve's probability to be to know anything. These are all public, yeah. Yeah, everything in this stage is public, yeah. Yeah. And the parity of the subsets become the final key. So this parameter S, it turns out that Eve's probability of knowing anything is exponentially small in that parameter. So you can choose that parameter to be as large as you want, depending on how paranoid you want to be about your security, or you know what level of security you want. So we estimated an error rate of about 20%. Now, we know that if Eve just measured, for everyone Eve measured, she had a probability of a half of getting the right basis, probability of a half of getting the wrong basis. if she got the wrong basis, there's a probability of a half that she introduced an error. Okay, so the probability she chose the wrong basis should be about, should correspond to about twice the probability that she introduced an error. So yeah, the probability that Eve chose the wrong basis and introduced an error should be about double the probability that they did, the probability of error that they detected. So about 4 in 10. And similarly, if the amount of time she got the right basis is about the same as the amount of time she got the wrong basis. So this is all to estimate how many bits are known by Eve now. So a rough estimate is about double the error rate. So should I go over that, or is that clear how I've estimated it? Yeah, let's go over that. So when Eve intercepts a bit and makes a measurement, then what happens? We want to estimate how often she measured, how many times she measured. Well, the probability she chooses correctly is a half, right? And the probability she chooses the wrong basis is also a half. Okay. Now, when she chooses the wrong basis, half the time she introduces an error into Alice's and Bob's strings because she randomizes the measurement that Bob is going to make. So probability of error given wrong basis is a quarter. So the probability she chose the wrong basis is double the probability that she introduced an error. And similarly, the probability that she chose the correct basis and has information is double the probability that she introduced an error. So we can use our error rate to estimate how many of the signals she eavesdropped on and how many bits she might know now. So a rough estimate of how many bits she knows is double the error rate. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you're right. But overall, then the probability of an error is a quarter. Yeah, thanks. So in what we did, there are more general security proofs that I'll sort of touch on later. But we're going to assume for the moment that Eve used the same strategy as Bob. So Eve chose randomly between these two bases. And the time she chose the wrong basis, so the idea, suppose Alice prepared horizontal and Bob measured in horizontal and vertical, but in between, Eve measured in the wrong basis, the diagonal basis. Then the state that Bob receives, instead of being horizontal, is one of these two. And either of those has a probability of half of giving vertical, so a probability of a half of giving an error. So the subsets are size n minus k minus s. For what we've got left, we have 13 bits. And the estimated number of bits known by Eve. So we think Eve knows about 40% of the bits, so 5.2, thank you. So we think Eve might know. I think this is pretty conservative, actually. I suspect Eve doesn't know 5 of these bits, but maybe. So the maximum number, let's round up. So let's let k equal to 6 for our case, OK? So we think that Eve knows about half of the bits. So we should have 7 minus s subsets left. So of our 13, we want 7 minus s, where s is some security parameter. Let's make this fairly easy on ourselves and just divide this into, I don't know, like 3 subsets, let's say. So 3 subsets of size 4, 4, and 5. Let's see. We can make 4 subsets. Let's make s equal to 3. So then we get 4 subsets. And we will end up with 4 bits at the end, OK? So we choose at random 4 subsets of our 13 bits. Is everybody with me? And it's going to be the parity of that subset that will become the final key. OK, so 4 subsets of 13. What do we have? 4 and 6. OK, so 3, 3, 3, and 4. Okay. So the final key, don't announce it yet, but write it down, please. For Bob, for Alice and Bob, the parity of bits 4, 6, and whatever the next one was, 36, I think. Okay, let me keep track of this too. Okay, 4, 6, and 36. The next one is 37, 40, and 43. And the next one is 44, 51, and 52. And the last one is 64, 66, oh, and 58. Yeah, 56, sorry. OK, the last one is 56, 58, 64, and 66. So Alice and Bob, you've calculated them? OK, good. So. This is the last part of what Alice and Bob do, the idea, again, of taking the parities of the subsets is that it's something that Eve will know very little about. So if we have a subset of size 3 and Eve knows one of the bits but knows nothing about the other two, then she doesn't know anything about the parity of that subset. So this is a way of amplifying the security or the privacy that Alice and Bob have and making sure that Eve has negligible information about the key. So Eve knew 2 bits of the final 13 and knows none of these final 4. So I guess the last test is to see if Alice and Bob's bits actually agree. So Alice, you want to call out the 4 bits? Even, odd, 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 and Bob?
I got it even, even, odd.
What? Oh. Oh dear. So we got 2 wrong after all that. Okay. So I hope that it shows the general principles of how these kind of things work, and also the limitations of a small sample size. So we only had 100 bits, and it's hard to estimate errors properly. As someone pointed out, if errors are collected in one point, then for a small sample, it'll skew it. I mean, you get an idea that you have to throw, right off, you have to throw away half, right? Because in the basis reconciliation. And, you know, the typical bit error rate, I think, is like, you know, less than 1%. So the subsets will be much longer. We won't be throwing, you know, we threw away 1 in 3. So probably the last thing we'll talk about is just more of a overview, some more general information. So we talked about a very simple attack strategy that Eve can make. And of course, when I first introduced this protocol, I told you what assumptions we were making, and that's that Eve is only limited by the laws of physics. So actually, there's a whole bunch of other kinds of attacks that Eve could make. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about attacks now. And I think in some of your later lectures, you're going to hear a little bit more detail. So the sort of strategy we talked about is called an intercept-resend strategy. It's, you know, kind of obvious why. So Eve intercepts the signal. She makes a measurement on the signal, and she resends it to Bob. And the state of the qubit she sends to Bob depends on the measurement result that she obtained. And we saw, I think, in the demonstration that Eve inevitably introduces errors if she does this. So there's a problem if Eve intercepts every photon sent by Alice and measures its polarization along some axis, she introduces an error rate of about 25%. But there are more sophisticated types of attacks that Eve could make. So one is Eve entangles the qubit sent by Alice with the probe system. So she performs some operation on the qubits that Alice are sending with some qubit that she has in her possession and entangles them. And she can later measure this. So she can keep this entangled system, send on the original qubit to Bob, and for example, she can wait until the bases are announced to measure her probe and try and get more information that way. But this also changes the state of Alice's qubit and therefore introduces errors. I mean, this is why the no cloning theorem is so important, because she can't obtain a copy. In the case where she entangles it with the probe, because Alice's state is now, because the state sent from Alice to Bob is now entangled with something else, it's changed and there are errors in it which can be detected. So even though she has some information in the probe, she still has to introduce errors because she's changed the state. And I mean, you can show that she can't get any information without disturbing the state, but I mean, suppose she tries to do a simple thing that copies H and V. So this is like our no cloning discussion yesterday. If she has some operation that can copy H and V, then it changes this to an entangled state. And now when Bob measures this, he'll have errors in his string if he chooses the right basis. And this obviously isn't the most general kind of probe that she can do, but maybe enough to say that if she entangles her system with the probe, so thereby getting any of the information about the system, she has to change the state of the system, and therefore she introduces errors. Okay. And the other thing she can do, which is a bit more sophisticated again, is to make a joint measurement on a large block of qubits. So instead of looking at each state that Alice sends individually, she makes a block measurement on a bunch of them all at once, and see if she can get more information that way. So I'm not going to talk about the details of the security proof, because I think it's just more detailed than you need to know. But just to let you know that all these cases are covered by security proofs. So the basic principles are what we've talked about, that Eve can't eavesdrop passively. She can't clone quantum information. And if she gets any information out of the signal sent by Alice, then she must introduce some errors into the string. So that's the basic conceptual ideas that just come from quantum mechanics. And then there's the mathematical stuff, that there are security proofs existing that show that the protocol we've talked about is secure against any attacks allowed by quantum mechanics. And with schemes like what we talked about today, so with classical error correction followed by privacy amplification, it's known that you can tolerate errors of up to about 11%. So this should already give you an idea of why we have problems in our final key, because we estimated our error rate to be about 20%, and that's not covered by the security proofs. It's too high for this kind of security proof, which is classical error correction followed by classical privacy amplification, and that's what we did this morning. So that's known that it can tolerate errors of up to about 11%. And then with a specific two-way communication protocol, which is more complicated than what we did this morning, it's known that we can tolerate errors of up to about 20%. And that's the Gottesman-Low security proof. And a little bit about the sort of state-of-the-art experimentally. So I think one of the biggest challenges, well, there's two challenges. One is distance, and one is one is the rate of generating the key, which a few of you have asked about. So this is some of the sort of state of the art. Vienna over 100 kilometers, Los Alamos over 144 kilometers. These are not all BB84, so I pointed out that this one was BB84. Tokyo, I've also included the rate at which key was established. So you see over 100 kilometers of fiber, the rate at which key can be established is only a kilobit rate, which is, you know, significantly lower than your broadband using public key cryptography, which is what's currently used on the internet. So it has a little bit to go to be able to be feasible on a broader sense like that. And over longer distances, it's only 12 bits per second was all they managed. similar at Geneva, 6 kilobits per second over 100 kilometers, and they managed to push a distance to 250 kilometers, but again, it's of the order of 10 bits per second, 15 bits per second in this case. And the highest bit rates demonstrated are megabits per second. So that's, you know, sort of getting there, and that's over only 20 kilometers. So the next thing that people are starting to think about is having networks of these things, because and repeaters, quantum repeaters are kind of the next thing that's important in using this technology, so that we can establish networks all over the world, because a link over a few hundred kilometers is just too long. The rates at which you can establish key are so small. So the next step is networks. So I mentioned that networks are kind of the next important thing. And people are starting to set these up already. So there's some in Boston, Vienna, Tokyo. And there are at least 4 companies offering commercial systems. So this is the first example of quantum information that's commercial. Like, there really are commercial system companies offering this. And there are others, Toshiba, HP, that have divisions that are also working on this. So there's always errors. And so commercial systems, you know, there's errors, and they correct those errors, and they do some of these techniques that we talked about. It's not because of an eavesdropper, usually. it's because of errors in the measurements, errors in the preparations, in particular errors in the channel. Actually, the biggest problem, as I've sort of alluded to, is loss. It's not so much error. If you want to do this over large distances, the photons just get lost in the transport. But there's definitely, I mean, these polarization measurements we talked about, polarizing beam splitter, they're good to maybe one part in 200 is pretty good to, so it's supposed to perfectly transmit horizontal light and reflect vertical, but it might be good to about one part in 200. So then you expect an error rate of about 1 in 200, for example. So yeah, there are all sorts of components that can cause error as well. Yeah.